Good morning, everyone. Welcome to today's lesson. So today's lesson, we are going to look at pneumonia and appendectrix. So we are going to look at the nursing care plan of a child with pneumonia. So the identified problems are as follows. First of all, as we can see from this picture, it's a summary of what goes on when a person has got pneumonia. So in the respiratory system, so when there is inflammation of the airways, in this case the alveoli, there is inflammation. If there is inflammation, there will be accumulation of fluid, as we can see this side. So when there is accumulation of fluid, there will be reduced surface area or gaseous exchange. As we can see the other side, where there is no inflammation, there's just clear air spaces where gaseous exchange is taking place. Now when it comes to the inflamed alveoli, when there is accumulation of fluid due to inflammation, there will be reduced surface area for gaseous exchange. As a result, this will cause the problems that a patient will have. So these are some of the problems that a patient with pneumonia is likely to have. So the first one is difficulties in breathing, which can be evidenced or manifested in different ways, such as maybe labored breathing, ineffective airway clearance, reduced oxygen saturation. So all these problems, similar problems, can be grouped as one, as difficulties in breathing, as we will see as we go on the presentation. So the next problem is chest problem, chest pain. Then the third one is fever. The fourth one is altered nutrition. Then the fifth one is the knowledge deficit. So these are the most likely the problems that the patient will present with. So notice that there may be other problems that the child may have, but in this presentation we are going to focus on these five problems and how we are going to manage them. So as we can see, this is how you're supposed to make your nursing care. Please, if you're writing your exams this year, make sure that you know how to write your nursing care plan perfectly, because if you know this, it will help you to gain many marks, more marks. So if you don't know, make work on me how you need to perfect your skill on how to draw the nursing care plan and how to write it. So you can use this presentation as well to help you master how to write your nursing care plan. So we start discussing our problems as we listed above. So the first problem we said is difficulties in breathing. So notice that as you draw your nursing care plan, it should have these corons and lows, and you should label them accordingly. So you need to have the date and the time, you need to have the identified problems, you need to make a nursing diagnosis, you need to come up with your objective, you need to now come up with your interventions and the rationale for all your intervention and the evaluation after your interventions. So let's continue. So the first problem that we identified is difficulties in breathing. So we said this can be manifested in different ways, such as ineffective breathing patterns. It is the same problem. So under our nursing diagnosis, we have said the patient will have difficulties in breathing. The patient will have difficulties in breathing. So under our nursing diagnosis, we are saying difficulties in breathing related to inflamed lung parenchyma cells and reduced space for gas exchange in the alveoli, which is evidenced by labored breathing and chest enjoying. So when you see a child is having labored breathing and chest enjoying, you should know that this is the problem which is coming about due to the inflammation of the lung parenchymal cells. So now, under our objectives, we've said that the patient will need to maintain effective airway clearance and adequate tissue perfusion within 30 minutes of admission. So for difficulties in breathing, our aim is that we want the patient to maintain adequate tissue perfusion. And then under our nursing interventions, we are going to monitor oxygen saturation using a pulse oximeter or a cardiac monitor. So when the patient just comes, we are going to connect them on the cardiac monitor, or if there is no cardiac monitor, we can use a pulse oximeter so that we'll be able to monitor oxygen saturation levels. And the rationale for doing this is that we want to determine the level of oxygen saturations. And under our evaluation, so under our evaluation is that the patient will maintain normal oxygen saturation levels of 93% to 100%. So this is under our evaluation. So the second intervention is that we want to administer oxygen therapy using a mask or a nosoprom. So administer humidified oxygen by mask or nosoproms. So why are we doing so? The rationale is that we want to promote tissue perfusion. Then the third intervention is that the patient can be convinced on CPAP. So we do so to prevent lung collapse. The other interventions include suction any secretions from the nose and mouth. And the rationale is that we want to clear the airway and prevent aspiration. The fourth intervention is that we want to change patient position frequently. For example, every after 2 hours or 2 hour returnings should be done. This is done to assist in mobilizing secretions and prevent hypostatic pneumonia. So hypostatic pneumonia is another form of pneumonia which a patient can have if they are immobile, if they are not moving in bed. So we have to help them to prevent this type of pneumonia. Then the fifth intervention is that we want to ensure adequate fluid intake. If the patient is on IV fluids, we want to monitor input and output. So why we want to do this is that we want to thin or liquefy the circulation. So we administer fluids. If the patient is on fluids, it will help to liquefy the circulations, which will be easily expected. So the second problem we identified is the chest pain. And under our nursing diagnosis, we said chest pain, especially when breathing in, related to pleural inflammation evidenced by a child crying a lot. Then under objectives or aims, we want to relieve the patient from pain and promote comfort. So under our interventions is, first we are going to assess the level of pain. We are going to notice, is the patient crying too much? We're going to assess the level of pain. Why are we assessing the level of pain? In order to ascertain the type of pain management to give. And under our evaluation is that the patient will be free from pain. Notice that I just forgot to write free there. So the patient will be free from pain throughout hospitalization. The patient will be free from pain throughout hospitalization. So you can just put free from pain, free here, free from pain throughout hospitalization. Then coming back to our interventions, the second intervention is that we'll minimize handling of the patient to avoid causing more pain to the child. Then also we are going to perform all the nursing procedures in block or at once so that we give the patient enough time to rest. Then other interventions include prescribed analgesics such as paracetamol. Our rationale is that we want to relieve the patient from pain. Then the fifth intervention is that we will give prescribed antibiotics such as benzyl penicillin. Why we are doing that is that we want to eliminate the causative organism. This will promote quick recovery. So the third problem we identified is fever. So the nursing diagnosis for fever is that fever related to the presence of pathogens and the inflammatory process taking place in the child's body. So under our objective is that we want to relieve the patient from fever and prevent complications such as convulsions. So it is important to know that if a patient is having fevers that are not being managed well, they can easily have convulsions. So we want to prevent this, especially in children. So under our interventions, we are going to monitor the temperature hourly in the critical phase. Why we are doing that is that we want to detect fever or to notice if it is reducing or not. That is after we have done the interventions. And under evaluation is that the patient's temperature will be reduced and maintained within normal ranges within 30 minutes of dictation. So the second intervention is that we are going to tepid sponge the patient using lukewarm water, and the rationale is that we want to reduce fever. Then we want to remove extra clothing and blankets. We are doing that to reduce fever as well. Then we are going to give prescribed antipyretics such as diclofenac or paracetamol to reduce fever as well. Then we are going to give prescribed antibiotics such as Xpen to eliminate the causative organism, which will result in the reduction of full body temperature. So the third problem that we have identified is altered nutrition. So under the nursing diagnosis, altered nutrition less than body requirement related to increased metabolic rates. And as we may be aware, if a child is severely ill or critically ill, they may have difficulties in feeding. So it is why we need to know how to manage such a child. So under our objective is that we want to prevent hypoglycemia and maintain the nutritional status of the patient throughout hospitalization. So under our nursing interventions, we are going to do the following. First, we are going to monitor patient's random blood sugar. Why we do so is we want to ascertain the level of glucose in the blood. Then under evaluation is that patient will maintain their nutritional status and hypoglycemia will be prevented throughout hospitalization. So the third intervention is that we should observe patient's ability to eat or to breastfeed. So we should be able to observe if the patient is eating or they are not, and if they are breastfeeding or not. Now, if they are critically ill, they may have difficulties to feed. So now it is our responsibility to help the child to feed. So why we do that is that we want to ascertain if the patient is able or is unable to feed so that appropriate measures are taken. So the third intervention is that if the patient is unable to eat or to feed on their own, we are going to insert a nasogastric tube. And why we'll do that is we want to administer nasogastric feeds, or we want to help the child to feed through the nasogastric tube. Then after that is done, we are going to be feeding the child through that nasogastric tube. Then next, we are also going to administer the prescribed fluids. So if the child has been put on fluids, we want to do that to prevent or correct any dehydration that may be present. Now, if this child is critically ill and they are even having increased respirations, they are having fevers, they are at high risk of losing a lot of body fluids. Now, it is our responsibility that we help these children to maintain a good fluid balance in their body, and we can do that by administering intravenous fluids. Then the last intervention is that we have to monitor strict input and output and record on the fluid balance chart. So we need to make sure that if the child is on intravenous fluids, we should monitor and record these fluids on the fluid balance chart. And the rationale is that we want to prevent fluid overload, which may cause more problem to the child. So that's why we need to manage it accordingly. Then the other problem we identified is knowledge deficit. So the nursing diagnosis under knowledge deficit will come about or related to lack of exposure to the condition and treatment, which can be evidenced by parents appearing very anxious and asking a lot of questions. So parents may be very afraid when they see their children having difficulties in breathing, the children being put on oxygen, maybe on monitors, on cardiac monitors. It can cause the parents to feel anxious and afraid that they may lose their child. So this can cause anxiety to them, and it is our responsibility to help calm and equip these parents with knowledge about the pneumonia. So under our objective or aim is that we want to equip the patient and the family members with knowledge about pneumonia, and also to allay any anxiety family members may have. So under nursing interventions, we are going to assess the patient's understanding. So notice that here we are putting patients and the parents, because they are children, because we are dealing with both the children and their parents. So we are going to assess their level of understanding about pneumonia by asking them questions. So we can ask them, what do you know about pneumonia? How does it come about? So we are going to ask them questions so that we know the level of understanding, because others may have wrong assumptions about how it comes about. So it is now our responsibility to explain to them how it comes about in simple terms, so that they understand the situation that their child is in. So the second point is that we want to educate both the patient and the family about the condition, e.g. how it is acquired in simple terms. Remember that if the child just came from home, they can have a community acquired pneumonia. Or if the child has been on the ward for some time, they can have hospital acquired pneumonia. So it is our responsibility to explain to them in simple terms so that we promote understanding. And in the end, we want the parents and the patients to demonstrate an adequate level of understanding about the pneumonia. So the next intervention, we are going to explain every procedure before commencing it, such as oxygen therapy. We need to explain for them before we commence the oxygen therapy so that we promote understanding and the cooperation. Then we also have to teach them the proper handling of circulation, such as covering of the nose and mouth with a tissue when coughing or sneezing and discard it accordingly. So we are doing this to prevent infection and the spreading of the infection. Then the last point is that we are going to stress the importance of hand washing after coughing and sneezing or expectorating to prevent infection and reinfection.